Hello and welcome back. This is David Reinhold. I am doing a stream of making of Merle, or better said, let's make Merle. Kind of like a let's play. You just watch me kind of sculpt this model. Testing out the stream format. Kind of trying to see how it works, see how it works in my artistic process. Kind of testing to see what kind of music works. So right now I've got this music pretty loud. Different kind of music, and since it's just a test stream, we'll kind of see how much it affects viewing performance later. So today we're going to be previous episodes. We worked out the base mesh for the jacket, the jeans, her Converse shoe, and now we're going to go and focus on her cute little beanie. So what I've got here is a bit of a base mesh, still from the just real rough blocking phase. I'm going to go over this. This isn't the base mesh, this is really just a dynamesh, can't even call it the base mesh. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through here and do a basic retopo, kind of adjust the shape, get it working, looking kind of like it is on this reference photo I've got right here. This is the first stream that I'm going to be doing in an after work format, so I'm kind of curious as to see how my energy levels are going to be doing, if I can actually manage to talk through this whole thing, or if I'm going to start ending up in some sullen silences trying to just get the fuck like into my modeling. So probably a familiar sight by now. I'm going to be switching to my topo brush, kind of start by outlining the basic shape that I'm going to be going for here. In this stream, I'm especially interested in any sort of feedback others might have, anybody who's watching this might have, on the way I'm talking. Am I talking too fast? Am I talking too abstractly? Are my mental jumps just make more sense in my own head and don't really communicate well? I've been kind of looking at my streams and critiquing them for myself, but it's not going to be anything compared to the kind of feedback I get from you guys. So let me know how you think I'm doing, how you feel the stream is going, etc. I'm also doing a little bit more of a preferred music section. I think for this off topic, back to the mesh here. I've got this problem that this right here is kind of getting into the way, so I'm gonna try and hide those, kind of invert that and then hide the unmasked points. That's not gonna help me at all. Because what I want to do is I actually want to model the topology underneath the little snowball shape. How am I gonna do this? This is a toughie. The base mesh did not have any. Did not have this flat, since I was just going for a shape. High point. I'm just going to delete that and insert back in later. So one option for this hat would be to map the topology in a way that this inner structure is going with the topology. But since it's doing some really kind of elaborate knitting structures right here, I think that I'm going to leave that entirely up to the texture and not focus on sculpting in any of that detail, since it is something that really is going to come in during the UV section of the modeling process. So I'm just going to be a super quick model probably, just because it's not really that much to do with the hat, so I think this will go pretty speedily. Might even get to detailing the pants, which I kind of figured I'm probably going to be doing next. I'm going to make a logo like this. Come through here, kind of have the hole right here, I guess. I'm gonna go to that. How am I going to do that? I have to not kind of murmur into my... have to not do that. That's kind of something I noticed while watching the videos, is that I do a lot of hand murmuring, and that is not a good thing to do. Especially when you're trying to communicate with people. Let's see what happens if I do that. Should I put a pole in there, or should I not put a pole in there? I'm gonna stick with that pole just because I think it's going to smooth a little bit better that way. Just gonna kind of test that out. Otherwise, I can always collapse it later on. So for here, same question. Am I gonna make this into a giant pole? So basically, a pole vertice is one with more than four edges coming from it. And you want to kind of be very conscious of where you're placing your pole vertices in your model. Like, for example, this would almost be a little bit too much. I would probably take that out to make it only five. Poles should generally never have more than five vertices. Right. So... gotta be conscious of that. Don't want to have that many poles. Kind of keep it to a minimum, because they're going to be what defines your edge flow. And I think I'm going to go with that option I had here. And then probably make another one here, going down through the bottom. So this is going to be opening up this area here to have that round shape. Yeah. Now I'm gonna be placing, making this face change topology. And now right here, so you've got two types of poles you're gonna be using in your models. You've got the five-sided ones and the three-sided ones. And the three-sided ones are basically where the topology is turning inward, and the five-side one is going to be making the topology turn outward on that side. So if you imagine it like a car lane, you know, your little car, that's my red cursor here, is driving along the same, right? And then it comes to this turn, and it's supposed to turn around. So it's going to go here. It gets, this three-sided pole is always going to be the inside of the turn. So the car's going around here. All these lanes are going around here, and right on the inside of that curve is where that three-sided turn is going to be. On the other hand, if your car is going to be driving along this lane, and you're turning in this direction, wait, no, I think I'm actually just skewing, is it the other way around? Three side should be on the inside of the lane. Right here. Oh, well, it's on the inside of this lane. Okay, so I guess I've always looked at my edge flow going in one direction with the on the inside, but obviously there's going to be the opposing lane, which is going in the other direction. So, yeah, the inside of one lane is always going to be the outside of another turn, so... This topology here is turning inward, and this one's going outward. Basically, you've got three-sided poles and five-sided poles, and you use them to guide the flow of topology along your model. Yeah. I don't know what I was saying there with the car. That was... did not think that thought to the end. Just me going on off rails. Going off-road. Probably in an off-road car pool. Anyway, I'm gonna go with this hat shape. I'm gonna split on mass points. And I'm gonna go ahead and hide that reference mesh. Kind of looks like a very odd helmet right now. We're gonna go about fixing that and get it more into the shape we've got in our reference. Reference shape seems to be going really low here. Smooth brush to got way too much Z intensity, so I'm gonna go in and dial that Z intensity back. I'm doing that by holding shift to switch to my smooth brush and then pressing the space bar to bring up my intensity menu, and that way I can quickly adjust the Z intensity of this brush, which is basically how much is it going to affect this model. I'm really kind of thinking that I might want another edge loop here, so I'm going to go and see if I can smooth this out. And in order to get that edge loop, I'm actually going to be switching to the Z Modeler brush. Isolate these edges here, and I'm going to kind of paint them. I don't really want to group them as of right now. I want to save that group. But I am going to isolate them and then go ahead here and turn switch to inset. And inset all this as a region. I'm going to keep both. Fortunately, it's going to actually kill my polygroup anyway. But shouldn't matter too much. I'm going to inset this entire polygroup now, just to get one more loop in there. That's definitely appealing to me a lot more, just as far as edge flow is concerned. This will move the pole up here and give it a little bit more room to breathe, so that this triangle shape here comes out a bit more. Move all of this out. Yeah. One thing I'm seeing here is that this, something that I have in my cap is kind of angling downward a lot more. I think what I want to change that and make it be a little bit more preppy, since Merle is that very preppy kind of character. I noticed that there's a seam down the edge. This is what happens when you're symmetrically using the topology brush and then generate the topology from it. So I'm going to go ahead and uncrease that border in order to get my dynamic subdivision looking a little bit more correct in that area. BMV. I'm going to grab my move brush here. And I'm going to just pull this out a lot. Trying to get that silhouette. Oh no! I forgot to turn my X symmetry on after uncreasing that. So I'm gonna go switch here, go back into dynamic mode. Now I've got my X symmetry on. It's one of those old things that will never stop haunting you, is making sure you have X symmetry on. God damn. It's just never gonna stop. I'm going to turn off ghost transparency just so I can get a better visual image of the model in my head. Trying to get this shape here a bit more. I think what I might be doing wrong is that this hair is not the kind of hair that would be under a beanie right now. So I'm going to pull this in and try and get that shape a little bit more defined here. I'm going to turn on AccuCurve since this is kind of a pinch point for the hair, and what we were saying in a previous episode is that whenever we are kind of pulling something that should be a corner, and in this case a pinch point, we want to use the AccuCurve since it's going to really define that pinch. Same with the... Actually, I'm going to turn it off for this, since this isn't really a pinch point. Ghost transparency, kind of trying to figure out where the actual head is. It's going to be in here. Since this is an elastic, it seems. I'm going to pull it a little bit out to add a little bit more room for the hair, but not a great amount, not a huge amount. Also, another problem with something that I notice myself doing a lot in when I'm sculpting in 3D is to sculpt from the different views and to adjust the object from those views, and it will start to get this very rectangular form. It's something that have to keep on catching myself at, making sure that it doesn't happen. Gonna keep adjusting that shape. Try and get a little bit rounder and get that shape here. Don't want to go too in much into the gnome direction, but I still want to go and make sure she has a bit of a Zipfelmütze, is the German term. It's a pointy hat, I guess is the best way of describing it. It's the kind of hats that gnomes have. It's what you call a Zipfelmütze. Zipfelmütze. Kind of looks a little bit much like a helmet right now. I'm going to try and pull it in a little bit more and squeeze that hair. I'm also going to switch the perspective to be able to better judge my model as I'm sculpting. It's another thing that really most sculpting should be done from the perspective view and not from the orthographic, because you're going to get a much better feel for how your model is going to be reading in 3D space. I'm going to go in here and adjust the hair a bit more. I'm going to turn on my AccuCurve, get a pinch under the cap. Turn it on here where I don't want it to be pinched. Continually going in and out. I'm going to turn on the move topological to grab individual strands. And really get it squeezed in there. The previous model that I stole this hair from was also for this video game. And he does not have any sort of a head covering involved, since he is going to be spending most of his time indoors. I think all of his time, in fact. Yeah, so it's going to be a lot of adjusting back and forth to try and get the hair to look proper underneath of a cap, since it was designed to kind of be more of the free-flowing kind. But I think it's much easier to go this route than to model the hair under a cap and then go free-flowing, because either you're not going to be modeling all of the hair strands, or you're just not going to be paying attention to the ones under the cap. I guess, in general, it's just easier to delete information than to add more to it, and since I'm more or less deleting the information, quote-unquote, that's under the her beanie, I'm happy with having modeled the hair without the hat first. B for the move brush, untopological, so I can move the larger hair masses. Try and get a little bit more even. There we go. What's great also is that this hair already has UVs, because otherwise that would be a very large hassle to do retroactively. I'm gonna make the hat in general a bit fluffier. I'm going to redo that. Seems like I've got a bit of a triangle here, which is fine by me. It's actually, I think, kind of adding to the whole effect. That way we've got these triangle flaps look a little bit more like they are organically flowing out of the rest of the hat, and not as attached. I'm gonna take that one hand jump here, and we're here for the. Is this symmetrical? Oh, seems like it. Wow, it's amazing how much of a turn off perspective and just double check. It would suck if it weren't, but it does seem to be exactly symmetrical. Wow, crazy what how your eyes can play tricks on you because just, and I think this is the effect of the jacket. Gives the right side of the hat a lot more weight. Very kind of an exciting thing happening there visually. It seems a little too fat for me here along the side, so I'm actually going to go and skinnicize this out. Make it real skinny. I think I like that. Do I like this more? No. Actually, what I want is I want both worlds. I want it to be skinny on the inside and then get fat along the edge. Can I do this? Can we do this, David? Yes, there's edges here and there. And we're just going to make it middle of it skinny. Yeah, here we go. This way it'll give a little bit more weight to the bottom here, which is also going to be where the warps are going to come from. And while I'm at it, I might as well use an insert multi-mesh for the bubbles, I guess you could call them. Yeah. I want to go to my Google Drive brushes. Where'd they go? Here we go. Gonna go into the insert multi-mesh brushes, IMM. Not to be confused with ILM. Insert rope. This is the one I want, since it's gonna have pretty much the same texture as my rope. Oh my goodness! That is a very unfortunate. I might make it a... Damn, this is really, really... need to definitely take my curve step down. But now it's not merging them for some reason. What is going on? What is this? Does my curve step actually need to be one exactly? Oh, it would seem that way. Oh, no. Okay, this is going to be... Well, what we can do is maybe take the strength multiplier up a bit to make it larger. No, that's only one direction. Take that one. Curve resolution, take this up. Nope, that is definitely not helping. This is not the rope that I wanted. Let's see if I can find a better one. Might be one in the rope brush. This is probably the one I wanted. Yes, yes, so much better. I don't know who made that other rope, but it is not the kind I want. Not into my kind of rope. There we go, this seems to be a good thickness. I'll clear that, and now see where I'm gonna do them separately. Yeah. Take this, how long I want them to be. I want them to be about this long. And what I really like doing is I'm going to lock the start here and kind of play around with this end of the rope, which gives it a really organic feel. I'm going to get my effect brush going a little bit larger here. Probably going to adjust this rope later. I think what I'll do is actually turn off asymmetry. And draw these separately since it is going to be falling very different on the edge, and I don't trust our animator to want to break the rope. I think she'll definitely just skin wrap it to the rest of the body. So let's see. What feels like a natural position for this bobble to be in? If I was a bobble, how would I fall? Twinkling from the sky, that's for sure. There goes the evil Twinkie, twinkling from the sky like a little bottle. Yep, that's definitely a future I agree with. Do I want it to be crumply? I do like a little crumple. Kind of take it like that, take it down. Yeah, this way it kind of looks natural.
Unnatural.
I'm gonna get a little bit more of a twist in here. Now if I could just get the curve in a tiny bit. Yeah, that looks like it's been placed there randomly by nature and the forces that be. Question is it going to look natural like this if she just stays like that? Is this a position this bubble would look? So I'm just gonna, and I don't think it is, so I'm just gonna take it out a little tiny bit more like that, like so. Yeah, that's a nice spontaneous feel. You wanna have that spontaneous look when you're making bubbles. Bubbles! Let's see if I still have a lock start. I do. It is still on. This one's approximately the same size, but this one's going to be following a lot straighter. Kind of get that asymmetric, spontaneous quality into, kind of see if I can get a bit of her personality. So I scrumple this up a little bit. I love the scrumpling. See if I can. I'll move that in later after I collapse the curve. Yeah, I like this crumple here, and then it kind of goes underneath here. Seems like I need to make it a little bit longer for it to match up and kind of look symmetrical, since this one's going to the side. I think this is a nice balance here. I'm going to go with this. Alright! So, kind of split these unmasked points, and move these strings into the center here. I have to figure out later how I'm going to model that knot in the detailing phase. For now, I'm not going to worry about it, just as well. I'll figure that out in the detailing phase. But having general shapes here is going to help. Next step, I think, would be to... I'm going to just insert some spheres. They're going to be replaced later by a... insert sphere? By a mesh with transparency planes, but for right now I just need something to remind me, hey, these are bubbles, and they are supposed to read bubbly. So I've got one here, it's gonna be fluffy. Could fiber mesh it, I suppose, but I don't think that's the way to go. Turn off dynamic, definitely don't need that kind of resolution right now. And then a final bobble. W up here. Alright, this is a really cute hat. I'm happy with how it turned out. Detailing is definitely going to be taking, going to work a lot more out of it. Split unmasked points. Let's see how we're doing here. I'll turn off that dynamic, it's going to just give me a little bit more performance. I'm going to take this out a little bit and squish it up a little more. And get a little bit cuter shape here. And one nice thing about the move brush is that if you take it like this and move that transform user a little bit more in center, and then take this one here, you can actually kind of add a clip curve effect to it. So, kind of showing off my clip curve effect knowledge right now. See if I can get this shape working a little bit better. So, music this time is a little bit more aggressive. One of the problems with the first session's music was that there was clean singing on the same frequency as I was talking. And obviously that is not a problem here. The question is whether blasting death metal is a desirable effect when watching a stream, and B, well, whether it interferes with my speaking on another level or if it interferes with my concentration. We'll have to see. I'm kind of curious to see. Working with blast beats in the background is definitely kind of a nice thing after a day at work. But obviously, if people get really distracted by that and do not enjoy the blast beats in the background, I'm gonna just switch back to some relaxing wave. I really want to make her smiling. She looks so sad. Oh my god. Can we just have her smiling a little bit? I know it's gonna... Oh, look at how smile... Oh, god. Haha! I have to turn on acting here for that death note thing. She looks so much happier like this. Oh, serious and sad. Happy! Serious and sad. Happy! You know what? I'm going to actually store more... I'm going to, store a morph target of her being sad and then, make her a little happy. Just so that I can get a little bit more motivated after a long day of work. I'm happy with how the hat's looking. I'm thinking of a lot of different ways to make the fuzziness on the baubles. What I definitely don't want to do is just keep them super round. I want to make them out of planes. But I've never baked those kind of planes, so I might spend the rest of the session working on the bobble hair planes. Which is going to be in a different sub tool. I'm going to start to do a save real quick though. Make sure that when I experiment around with fiber mesh and lots of different brushes, there's I'm going to have pretty unexpected results. I'm going to make this a polymesh 3D, turn into a huge sphere, scale it down a great bit. And the way I want to make these bobbles is I want to bake these textures with the opacity onto planes. So the planes are going to be generating in Blender, but I want to generate some high resolution fibers here in ZBrush. I used a similar approach on my Thieban helmet, which you can see on ArtStation. I'm going to just drag it over here to illustrate what this final result is looks like. I don't want to manage my portfolio, I just want to look at my things and show something. So here I have a these hair planes I baked and actually rendered directly in ZBrush. That way I had a perfect alpha channel. And that worked really well for a flat surface. What kind of challenge that I'm going to be setting myself modeling these bubbles is that I want to actually model a cylinder for each of these planes and then duplicate that cylinder all around, because I think it'll give it a more full shape. These flat planes work really well for this helmet, but for the bobbles, I'm going to kind of go into new experimental territory and see if I can make something interesting. Am I really going to do this? Are you really going to do this, David? Or are you going to do that what you feel safe with? Because he could just do it with planes. I'm going to flip a coin. Because I know I can do it with planes, but I'm kind of interested in seeing how it could work with bottles. Just flip a coin. I'm going to go for... Oh, shit. I didn't decide what I wanted. Okay, I'm going to have the bobbles with cylinder be tails. Oh, okay, so I guess I'm going to be using a cylinder. Okay, first things first, generate the high-resolution geometry. I'm going to go into the lightbox fibers just to get started here. I want to have really kind of these thick threads of fiber. So, see if I can find something that kind of has that shape right from the outset. These are all more hair-oriented, which makes sense, obviously, because fibers are usually used for hair. I might get something interesting from... If I just use this, and then turned off my gravity and the modifiers. Gravity. Zero. Now I want to have less fibers, way less fibers. I don't want it to have any sort of a twist, I want them to be pretty straight. Let's see what these look like right now. They're really super skinny because they've got a lot of scaled root and tip are not the same. So I'm going to go with having a 3 scaled root and a 3 scaled tip. So it'll make them super fat. Let's see what that looks like. Still not the kind of exact fluff I want to have for these bottles, but getting there, I actually wouldn't mind them being even fluffier than this. So I'm gonna say my slim variation coverage would be much thicker. Yeah, yeah, here we go.
Super thick fibers.
Profile, I don't need a texture. Texture off. And am I gonna colorize them? Yeah, I'll make them a little yellow along the base, because somehow these kind of things always get a little yellow to the base. Might be an interesting effect, I'm not sure if it's gonna get me anywhere, but. Needs to be thicker, gonna have need more segments. Three? Okay. I don't care about your redder iterations. I've got the power! More skill set. Coverage. Ah, width profile. This is what I want. I think they're actually gonna be a little bit fatter. Okay. That one, please. I skip this one. Thank you. I'm gonna, one way to get these little bottles to be, linear is to drag them off the edge and then back on. You can switch them up that way. Wonder why they're kind of like splitting off at the tip, if that's just a preview artifact or if they're actually gonna render that way. That's alright with me. I'm gonna actually give them a lot more coverage. I'm super fat. Super duper fat. I'm gonna make a lot no, actually this might be a good amount. I like this amount. I don't want that much length variation. Maybe a little tiny bit of them getting a little uneven, but not as much as I currently have. And then I can do a lot less too, so let's see what this looks like here. Still got that weird at the end, but might be a cool effect if only it weren't so aggressive. Coverage variation. I'm going to set that to very, very little. Slim variation, 0. Scale root, scale tip, I'm going to set that maybe 2, just a little bit tinier, smaller. I don't know, something about this. About the way this is working, it's just odd. If I reset this, make it completely straight, it should be straight like that, though. It's really odd. Maybe the length profile. Yeah, that's the variation, I think. Odd. But not something that wouldn't be able to be fixed later on. 4 segments. Let's actually go with 6 segments and make these a bit fatter. Oh, hey, maybe it was just the profile segment size which was messing that up so much. Fix up that width profile a bit more. Make it a bit thicker. Yeah, I like that. Length profile. What can we do here? Gonna do this. Max fibers by area. No, I did not want to edit that. That's, I think, a global. I'm not sure what that does. Turn off by mask. Everything gets fibers. Take it a little bit more. Get a nice fuzzy. So what I could also, well, obviously the lighting's not perfect. I want the ends to actually be flat. It's really kind of not what I'm going for here with this spiky, pointy edge, because these edges here do not look like that. Maybe it's in the width profile, but it's really odd. Probably in my settings here. Maybe if I change my profile back to 5, 4, nope, they are all getting merged. In my segments? No. Maybe more segments actually. Oh, yes. I love that twisty twist. That is really nice. Tip colorize. Tip variations. That's not going to be it. Clump variations. Let's actually have it clumping a little bit. That's a good idea. Yeah. Not as many clumps, but definitely a little bit. Color profile, don't need that. Gravity profile. We're gonna have a little bit of gravity. But I don't want to have too much. Slim? Oh man, there's a little bit of slim. So that's another, I think, new thing. Oh, is if you grab the slider above the object here, it's like a super slow mode. Yeah. This is starting to read a lot like a bottle. Scale tip. Oh, well, that could be why my tips are so skinny. I had them scaled down. I'm gonna set my scale tip to 1. And I think scale tip is actually the way, seeing how this works. Okay, I think I got it. Scale tip is a multiplier of scale root. So if I have scale tip at 0.5, it's gonna be 0.5 the scale of the root. And if it's 1, it's going to be the exact same scale as the root. I always thought I had to set them to 3.3, but now it's scale tip is actually multiplying the scale of the root tip, of the root of the strand. Okay, that makes a lot more sense. That makes a lot more sense. I am much happier with this now. So let's see here. What else can we add to get this a little bit more interesting in shape? Oh, not so much revolve. No, not so much revolve. Maybe a teensy-tiny bit? No, we don't want any revolve. We can have a tiny teensy-tiny bit of gravity, though. Kind of bring that back a little bit. Not too much, because we don't want it to be... Because these are pretty stiff strands. I'm going to actually add even more coverage to this. Yeah. Maybe do a little bit less fibers, and a little bit less... I want this to be thick, really thick. Maybe I have to change my area a bit more. Thicker and then make them shorter. They'll make less fibers. Yeah. Okay, that's a nice little puffball. I'm happy with this puffball. Now I said I wanted to bake this to a cylinder. Looking at it now, and I have to flip heads or tails about whether to bake it to a cylinder or to an airplane, I think the way to go might be to just definitely bake a root sphere from it, and then see how much of that sphere in the silhouette I can... keep editing, and how many planes I'll need to take from that sphere to make it have this frayed edge of it. So it's gonna stay exciting for sure. I'm gonna for now actually accept these fibers. Sure, turn on fast preview. And these, for these I'm going to duplicate this subtool and convert this top one to geo. See, it's only 1.2 million. I'm gonna go, seems like the ends are open. Maybe there's an option for that that I missed. But I'm just gonna go and close holes. I'm really enjoying how this is looking. Oh, that's so many profile segments. I did not need that many profile segments. That's why this count is so high. I'm gonna... gonna go and take my profile segments, my segments, way down. Oh, then they're not as pretty. Oh god, what the hell? I'll stick with this. This is good enough. And since it's gonna be baked, it doesn't matter that much. Very nice bit of visual noise, definitely going to attract the eye. But I don't know, I'm gonna bake this. I keep on pretending like I have a plan for this, but I really don't. This is going to be a tough thing to bake. I don't know how I'm going to do this. Maybe a random plane sticking out of it. Thing is, it really needs an uneven surface. It really needs that. So, I have no idea how I'm going to be making this. There's so many different methods flying through my head about how I should bake this. Maybe some of you will have a good idea. You can see this gorgeous parallax going on. I wish I could somehow transfer that to a game ready model. I don't know how I'm going to, though. This is going to be a tough one to bake. A very tough one to bake. I have no idea how I'm going to do this. That's Excitement of 3D. See, we'll have to see later how it reads in the model. For now, I think I'm going to go right ahead and append these fibers. Where are they? Oh, they are super tiny! Oh my god, they're so tiny! I did not think they would be this tiny. I guess I made it a little bit too small. Take that size up. I did this first time. That doesn't matter if it's symmetrical or not. This is just for me getting a little bit of more of a picture of what these areas will read like when designing the character. So I'm going to be baking from the actual puffball subtool. I'm gonna actually save this. Puffball! Oh, cap suck. Puffball. _01. And what? Oh, that's the old one. I did not want to talk about what that was. Yeah, a pop ball. And I'm gonna, when you control drag, you make a copy of the current object. And I'm gonna do that with the pop ball, and I'm gonna take that pop ball out and put it right here. Kind of to match that up. And this way I'll be able to much better kind of decide about, I'm gonna go on with my process of designing Merle. And make another copy, drag it back here. Scale this one up, make it much bigger. Yeah. Hey, super big, super cute. Ah, no, not that one. This way. There we go. Yeah. There we go. And then, just kind of scale this one in a little bit and do the same thing. Ah, no, I'm gonna let it go through the bunch. Okay. Now, make this invisible. And these balls underneath are actually going to be the ones that I'm going to be exporting. So I'm going to go ahead and just hide them for now. Split unmasked points. And hide them so that I'm sculpting and seeing the way it's supposed to look. But then when I export, I still have the positions already mapped out for me. Yep. And I think that's going to be it for this session. I went into detailing the hat a little bit and adding some puff balls. Super cute, super cute. Next session, I think I'm going to move on to the pants. Get some nice frayed jeans look in here. Already looking forward to that. Getting all those seams mapped out, sculpted in. Kind of looking forward to experiencing about if, whether, how I'm going to be inserting straps or how I'm going to be modeling these seams. Because I do prefer to model them out, putting them in the texture. I prefer to texture more procedurally than painterly. Painterly side of me, I do prefer doing in ZBrush. So super hyped to see how it's going to go with these pants straps. Until then, I bid thee a fair day or fair night, depending on where you are and what time you're watching this. If you enjoyed watching me sculpt Merle's hat, give this video a like. If you dislike this and definitely hate blast beats, give this video a dislike, and I'll see you next time.